So I'm presenting a case study on a relatively new group of journals. It's less than a year old. We formed it in August 2010. And some of what I'm going to say has been said before, so hopefully it's reinforcing and not redundant. I also have to admit that we were able to benefit from some of the challenges that they have, like archival issues that they have come up with earlier. We saw those beforehand, so we were able to come up with that. I don't have much about me in here, but I should say that I have 30 years experience in publishing. I was at Sage before I started this, and I helped Sage create their consortium initiative in 2006 and 2007 through 2009. So that's my own background. First of all, why consortia? That's been addressed, but I'd like to give my take on it. I think with the advent of electronic journals, historical forces have been unleashed that probably result in the inevitable final result of universal access to journal content. Everyone that wants to have access to content will be able to have access to content. There are two major strains. Are two major developments that are providing that solution, and one is based on the traditional subscription model, and is probably something that is more comfortable to us, and that's the consortium effort. The first consortium deal in the history of the world was created in the 1990s between Tom Sandville at OhioLINK, who's now at Lyrisis, and Academic Press, which no longer exists. They became part of Harcourt, now is part of Elsevier. The deal was created in order, and sometimes people forget this, for universities and institutions in Ohio who would never otherwise be able to get access to content to be able to get access to content. And that was the original driving force for consortia deals, and I think in many cases throughout the world it still is. Of course, the other alternative method for getting universal access to everyone that needs to have universal access is the open access movement. And of course, that's not an evolution, logical evolution from the subscription model. It's a radical break from the subscription model and perhaps threatens the subscription model. So those are the two choices we have, if I'm right, that these historical forces are inevitable. So this is why you should be, one of the reasons you should be participating in the consortia game. Other reasons, protection. I think many societies think, I want to get in the consortia business because I'll gain revenue. And that's true, or I'll gain access, that's true. But another reason, and to be honest, when I sat in at Sage, and one of the main reasons we decided to get involved in consortia business is to protect existing business. Because as mentioned earlier, as the library budgets get taken up more and more and more by consortia deals, the portion of the library pie, which obviously is not increasing, that is taken up by individual subscriptions is shrinking. So with every year that you're not in a consortium deal and you're relying on your subscriptions, your subscriptions are threatened by the consortia deals. On the positive side, usage goes up. One of the things I noticed at Sage, and I think most of you that have been involved in consortia deals, usage actually explodes. When we first saw usage going up as dramatically as it did, we questioned our own technology on whether the usage was actually as real as what we were seeing. With usage going up, that's important because it adds negotiating and pricing value to journals. As much as some consortia heads say that they don't rely on usage, when you get down to renegotiating a renewal contract, the first thing they bring to you is usage statistics. So usage becomes extremely important. That adds pricing values to your journals. With usage going up and with access going up, impact factors go up. And of course, that's extremely important. Most of you are probably familiar with a study that COPPIS, that's the main Brazilian consortium, did, I think 2 years ago. They presented it at London Online. They're one of the oldest consortia in terms of acquiring content. They acquired content throughout the first decade of the century. And one of the things they found out was that by adding content, there's a correlation between the huge numbers of journals they added and the research output of the country of Brazil. At the beginning of the decade, they were a relative footnote in terms of research output. By the end of the decade, they were, or by 2008, they were the number 16 country in the world in terms of research output. Another interesting corollary, and you can see this in other consortia, is that where previous to Coppice, the vast majority of research done in Brazil was done in a handful of universities, most of them in Sao Paulo. Even though still the bulk of research is done at three or four universities in Sao Paulo, the research has dispersed across other universities so that it's as people have access to obvious research, they create their own research, and so the research becomes dispersed across other universities. All of this is good for both us and for the research community. All of the above adds value to your journals. The history of ISPEG, Independent Scholarly Publishers Group. It grew out of a group called T-Focus, which is Task Force and Consortia and Institutional Sales. What all these publishers have in common is they're all on the Highwire platform. And most of them are science and medicine. In fact, I think all of them are science and medicine. They almost all have high impact factors or ranked high in their discipline, mainly societies like these other ones, and some small prestigious university publishers like Rockefeller University Press. They started a number of years ago. When I was at Sage, I used to sit in on their meetings just out of curiosity because Sage has their own sales force and we weren't really part of T-Focus. But one of their first initiatives was 2006, where they started with a China initiative. 50 publishers participated over a period of a little over a year, and it was not successful. They did not end up with a contract with China. You can debate on what the reasons are. I have fairly strong opinions on why it wasn't, but I won't go into here. But the positive news is that some of the publishers that did participate in that branched out on their own, created their own deals through people like Charlesworth, and now have very lucrative arrangements in China. The next initiative through T-Focus, once again this is where I became involved, was a Hong Kong, I think, hospital initiative in 2008-2009 timeframe. That also was not successful and did not end up with a contract. There was a T-Focus meeting at a Highwire meeting a couple of years ago where they decided, let's try it again. I remember sitting in the back of the room, they were saying, it's either India or Australia. Which one do we want to go to? I remember standing up as a disinterested bystander, because I was still at Sage, saying, you've got to be out of your mind. This is a no-brainer. You go to Australia, they have all the money, and that's the way you go. Most of you know Richard Getty. He also stood up from Oxford University Press, said the exact same thing. You're crazy if you go to India first. You should go to Australia. So they contracted with EBSCO and created an offer in 2010 for the 2011 subscription year, really 2 months before I became involved in this, and that ended up not successful either. Out of 50 universities, one university took it up. So, instead of going through all the reasons why these were not successful, I will flip it and say, what are the keys to success for small publishers with consortia? And I've identified four very, very, very strong key ones that I think are necessary. Each one of them are necessary. One is having a critical mass of content. You need to have a critical mass of content, and everyone up here does, for two reasons. One is if you contract with a sales organization and you don't have a critical mass of content, you're just one publisher. In most cases, you're going to be at the bottom of the totem pole. In other words, the sales organizations are getting their money from commissions from you. And if you have 50 journals, they're going to get more commission than if you have one journal. So just like everyone else, every business ranks their customers high value to low value, they will do the same thing. So it's important to have a critical mass of content to get the attention of the sales organizations. Perhaps even more importantly is to get the focus of the consortia themselves. Consortia do not want to deal with individual publishers, small publishers. This was brought to focus at a very good seminar that ALPS did in London shortly after UKSG, where there were several consortia there. JISC was there, the guy from Denmark, I think, was there, a guy from France, and people were challenging, someone in the audience here was challenging the person from JISC, why won't you deal with the small publishers? It's not that they don't want to deal with the small publishers, it's they don't have time to deal with the small publishers. Like you, they have limited resources. Some of them only have an administrative staff of 3 or 4 people. They don't have time to deal with 1,000 different small publishers. They would much rather deal with with one person representing a large number of publishers and journals. So critical mass of content's important. What's been hinted at before, appropriate pricing model for consortium. Each consortium presents a different scenario to you. It could be a mature consortium that is highly penetrated, that has lots of subscriptions. That demands a different kind of pricing model than a consortium of libraries that has hardly any subscriptions. Those are two extremes. So each one you have to analyze the consortium and decide what is the most appropriate pricing model for that consortium. Picking the appropriate sales organization. We decided to go out and pick sales organizations to represent different sales organizations for each territory. Now, ALPS picked SWETs for all of them. There's a certain efficiency, and that's a good thing to do as well. We decided to pick a different one for each territory. It's not just picking the best sales organization in terms of the ones that can sell the best. It's like recruiting an employee for your organization. It's not just picking someone with the best skill set. It's picking someone that is the best cultural fit as well, someone that can work with you and that can help you maximize sales. And finally, this is a piece that most people don't think of, and it's where I come in. It's called channel management. If you have a large sales organization, SWETS, EBSCO, Charlesworth, and they have many, many different products they're selling, it dramatically increases sales if you have someone that's channel managing that group on your behalf, if you have someone that's training them on how to sell the product, if you have someone that's working with their sales reps, showing their sales reps how to work the product, if you have someone that's calling them up weekly and asking them, what's in the pipeline, what's going on with this sale, what's going on with this sale, what's going on with this sale, that gets their attention. If they know that they're going to get a call from the channel management person, it kind of focuses their attention getting ready for the call. That's like me doing this presentation. I knew this presentation was happening, and I made sure it was ready, a few hours ago. So those are the four keys to success. Okay, what is ISPEG, Independent Scholarly Publishers? It's grown. It's now 19 publishers. It's not nearly as large as my friends here on the stage, but it's got 42 journals. It's got one ebook series. I believe that does provide a critical mass. We've been told. I know it does because we've been told by the different consortia around the world that's enough. Like I said, it was formed in August 2010. Here's the sales organizations that we picked. Impact for which is part of EBSCO, SWETS, PCG for Europe, Charlesworth in China, many of you work with them. And then I'm doing North America myself and possibly working with some other people. It's channel managed by Dragonfly, which is my company. Here's probably something that I probably should have come up with a stronger word than voluntary. It is almost it's a voluntary organization. It's almost a participatory democracy. It's We vote on everything, and it's which makes it interesting, and we try to arrive at a consensus. There's no clear democratic structure. It makes it actually, having come from, you know, nice but large companies like Thompson and Pearson, it actually makes a nice, interesting part of the change in my career, working for a company where it's not top down, but it's participating. It's working. By and large, it's working. We've arrived at a consensus, close to the consensus, on everything except one thing that we went round and round and round about, and that was contentious. And believe it or not, if you look at the upper left-hand corner of that logo, that was the one thing we argued about. So that went through a number of different renditions. And I think we're very good at creating appropriate pricing for each consortium and for each territory. By the way, looking at this list, if you look at where Key Focus might have failed, or where they weren't successful, they obviously had a critical mass. I don't think they had the appropriate pricing model, especially for China, although the people at Highwire would strongly disagree with me on that. They aren't channel managed. One of the problems with T-Focus, one of the challenges is everyone has a real job, and so they don't, the job that they do in terms of channel managing and working with the sales organizations is their secondary job. That's just not fair. They don't have, you know, you just can't devote enough time to do that. It'd be like having a consortium. If you think about it, these guys have talked about this as a consortium of publishers. That's a great metaphor. We are a consortium of publishers. But it'd be like having a consortium without a head of a consortium. Imagine CDL without Ivy Anderson, who's running CDL, and all the different heads of the University of California libraries are running CDL. It wouldn't work. You know, it just wouldn't work. Okay, I talked about different pricing models. I want to go through these just very, very quickly. Some of you are probably familiar with them. These I deliberately put them in order from the most conservative, that is, conservative meaning the closest to the traditional subscription model, to the most radical, that is, the most removed from the traditional subscription model. When Ian was talking about pricing based on print, that's what I'm talking about, traditional subscription model. So the first one is maintain holdings plus discounts for subscriptions. That was the model that was originally proposed for call by T-Focus. So you have to, the idea here is you have to continue to subscribe to the journals you're subscribing to, and then in the case of the call subscription, for a 10% discount, you get additional subscriptions. That only works if you're in a consortium or in a territory where there is a significant opportunity for new subscriptions that hasn't been maximized yet. But if you're in a mature market like Australia, and for those of you who've been to Australia, Australia is as close to the United States and Europe in terms of their academic tools, that's just not gonna work. If they're not gonna subscribe for full price, they're not gonna subscribe for a 10% discount or a 15% discount. Then the next level is the traditional, this is the most traditional consortium model, which is maintain subscription holdings. You have to continue subscribing to your present subscriptions, plus a top-up access for additional content. So for example, if you subscribe to 20 journals for $20,000 for a 20% top-up or $4,000 more, you get access to the rest of the journals. And that is the one that's been around for a long time. Every consortium in the world is familiar with that. Most consortia in the world are trying to move away from it. They just don't know what the next month. In fact, that was a big topic at ALPS on how do we move away from it. The third one is a variation, which is that John Wiley does it, which is you maintain holdings, but you can substitute in and out in different. That is, you can cancel a subscription, but you got to add one of equal value. The next one, now you start breaking away, which is a flip deal. Originally, a flip deal meant flipping from print to electronic, but really what it means is you don't have to subscribe to anything. We're just going to charge you a price. So what most publishers do is they say, okay, let's make sure we're not going to get screwed here. So let's say they're doing $100,000 in present subscriptions. If they canceled all of them, we need to charge them $150,000. So we're not going to make you subscribe to anything, but the price is $150,000. So the subscriptions go away, which has a certain advantage to the both libraries and to you, because all of that back office stuff goes away. And also then now you're totally removed from the print. You have, you know, you don't have the print holdings anymore, but you flipped over to another deal. And then a final thing, which I mentioned here, was a tiered pricing model. American Chemical Society created a model several years ago. Sage flirted with one. I think Oxford University Press actually was considering going to a model, basically based on research intensity. And in the United States, it's fairly easy to plug in universities into the Carnegie system for that. Just two specific examples, kind of maybe oversimplifications, but maintain holdings model for highly penetrated markets. That is where you have a lot of subscriptions. You want to protect those subscriptions. Australia is a perfect example. There is value to knowing what your subscriptions are. Societies want to hold on to their subscriptions. So Australia is a place where that typically has this model. Although Diane Costello told me recently that they are trying to aggressively move away from that. But still, that is the prevalent, she's the head of CALL, the head of the Australian Consortium. Then the flip model is where there's hardly no significant holdings. And most of the deals in China, Korea, and Brazil follow that model. COPPIS is you write one check, you receive it, and COPPIS gets, you know, their universities get access to your journals. Briefly, we sent out an RFP. We started in August. I wanted to make sure we had the right sales organizations for the right territories. So here's a list of the criteria that we applied. Market presence, you know, how well do you know the market? There was one sales organization in one territory that, when I was at Sage, arranged for a three-hour lunch with the two people responsible for funding the whole national consortium. Well, that sales organization had pretty good market presence. You know, that's someone that you might want to know. Sales capability. That sales organization may have good market presence, but maybe they don't know how to sell. They don't, you know, they don't see the closing signals. You want to see someone that has a good sales capacity. Ability to focus on us. I don't want someone focusing on, you know, the art to channel management, I've been told before, is to get the sales organization to spend more time selling your content than they should. And so that's what I want. Cultural compatibility, not only with the ISPEG structure, but are they willing to be channel managed? Some sales organizations just want to be left alone. Sign the contract, let us sell, don't bother us. Well, that's not the way we're working. We're working where they know I'm going to call them every week. Transparency, are they going to show us their pipeline? What is pending? What have they lost? If they lose something, I want to know, and I want to know why. So are they open to that kind of thing? Back office capability. We have limited resources. The societies have limited resources. We did a very good job of offloading all the back office, almost all the back office, the distribution of money, the invoicing, over to the sales organizations. Not every sales organization has the capacity to do that. This is a huge thing for us. And then compensation, I don't mean the cheapest compensation, but the most value for what you're paying the sales organization. Challenges. I told you we have a participatory democracy. Arriving at a consensus can sometimes be a problem. Sometimes it takes us multiple emails or long conference calls to arrive at that consensus. But once you, the positive side of this, once you get at that consensus, you have buy-in of everyone. An interesting thing is, when we voted for the sales organizations, we had 100% consensus in most territories. In one territory, we had one vote against what the other people voted for. In another territory, we had two votes against what the other people voted for. That's amazing when you think about a group of publishers. back office issues. There are issues, but I think we've come at limited resources. I mean, limited resources in terms of people resources. Some of the publishers I've worked for, they don't have a salesperson, they don't have a marketing person, they have a distribution person or something, and they're acting as their sales and marketing person. So that is a challenge for doing this. Geographical challenges, not only in terms of the sales organizations and the consortia being in different parts of the world, but last week we have Charlesworth. Last week we had a conference call. I'm in California, Adrian Stanley's in Philadelphia, and the Charlesworth Chinese people are in Beijing. So setting up that conference call can sometimes be challenging. And then budgetary issues, which is related to limited resources. There's only so much money we have, and every time we ask someone for something, they want money. And so we're trying to do things as cheaply as we can, but as effectively as we can. I think we're going to have a huge deal in call momentarily. You'll see the press release. It'll be a very, very, very successful outcome. I don't want to jinx it, but I think it's going to be, it looks very, very good. I was there in Sydney and I interviewed librarians for 3 days in a row. We have a new offer. Every librarian I interviewed over 3 days said they'd take up the offer. I've never been in a selling situation where I had 100% people saying yes. Coppice, we're very close to doing a deal with Coppice, which most people have anyway. We have multiple offers on the table in India. Some of them look extremely exciting. We have, surprisingly enough, I was at UKSG, we have people very, very interested in making deals with us because of the nature of our group in Europe and in some countries that are extremely financially constrained. China's been frozen in terms of buying new content for 2+ years. It's beginning to open up a little bit. We're very hopeful we'll have something by the end of the year in China. And we have, we're working on 4 offers today in Asia. So for having just started the sales organizations and starting in January, the early trends look pretty good. Thank you very much. I'm very happy the slideshow worked.